all of these movies have two things in common. Amazing, jaw-dropping special effects. And the man responsible for them. We sat down with special effects wizard Chris Corbould, who explained his role in designing and executing these moments with behind-the-scenes secrets of some of his greatest work. Subscribe and click the bell for more filmmaking videos like this.
Saved by the bell.
You've probably heard the terms special effects and visual effects used interchangeably, but there is a crucial distinction between them. Visual effects are anything done after production has wrapped. This is CGI, motion capture, compositing. Special effects, on the other hand, are done during production. This includes elements like rain, prosthetics, explosions, car chases, and more. Chris Corbould's career in special effects goes back decades, working in blockbuster franchises like Star Wars, James Bond, and the Dark Knight Trilogy. But what exactly does a special effects supervisor do?
Action!
The role of a special effects supervisor is obviously to design, collaborate with the director, the production designers, the stunt personnel, you know, to achieve what is in the written word of the script. Probably 70% of what we do in special effects is engineering, you know, whether it be rotating hallways, it can be sinking houses in Casino Royale, tube trains crashing through the ceiling in Skyfall. Engineering is a major part of what we do. Above that, it's to come up with ideas to improve the scripts, you know, make them different, make them more spectacular, make them more challenging. In GoldenEye, the tank chase was originally a motorbike chase. I was called in to see Martin Campbell, Barbara Broccoli and Michael Wilson, and they said to me, look, Chris, we're not really happy with the bike chase. Well, how can we make it different? I said, well, get rid of it. There's been lots of bike chases. So they said, well, what can you come up with? And I said, well, they're in a military park. Why doesn't he take a tank? And that's how that whole scene started off.
Faster!
I think it's the special effects supervisor's job to come up with these ideas.
For Skyfall, Corbould's task was to devise a thrilling conclusion to an underground chase sequence.
I got a call from Sam Mendes one afternoon, and he said, look, Chris, I've got this wonderful underground foot chase. Caverns and metro trains. He said, but I want one jaw-dropping moment just to bring it all to a stop. So he said, what can you come up with? And I thought, well, they're in the underground. Why don't we have a subway train crashing in through the scene? And that's how that whole sequence evolved. And I pitched it to Sam. He loved it. And then we set about designing it. There was some talk. We probably could have done it as a miniature. But at one stage, there was a lot of dialogue after the train crash, so we'd had to dress in a full-size train in the crash position. So I pitched it that we shot the whole thing, you know, full-size and do it for real, which everybody agreed. So then, you know, I got together with my engineering team. We came up with a methodology of an overhead monorail, if you like. So the train was actually hanging an overhead track that went from one corner of the 007 stage to the other corner in Pinewood Studios. And we hung two carriages. My initial thoughts was just to go and buy two out-of-date railway carriages until one of my engineers mentioned that they were 65 tons each. So we decided to make our own. So we made our own two carriages, which still came in at 5 ton each. We then had to devise how we drove it into the set. So we had a cable system with a tractor unit outside the stage going through a series of pulleys, which pulled the train in at about 30 miles an hour. And I walked around with Roger Deakin, the lighting camera on it, and we discussed where to put cameras, something like 10 or 12, I think. Probably the biggest challenge was stopping it, you know, because 10 ton coming in at 30 miles an hour, and we had to stop it pretty quick before it went out the other end of the stage. We had about 50 tons of sandbags right at the very end, so it just plowed into it and stopped it dead. But the whole set was a collaboration between, you know, the art department, construction, ourselves, because I didn't want it just to hit the floor and it skid along the floor. I wanted to plough the floor up. So all the floor was built of weak materials up to about a foot in depth. You know, there was lightweight pillars that it went through. Everything that it hit, it showed total destruction. So a lot of, it was a collaboration between, you know, all those departments for the success of that. And it was a one-off, really. To do it a second time probably would have been months and months and months of redoing the set. So we had to nail it first time, and we did, and it was a wonderful shot. You may not know it, but you may not even see it if you blink your eyes, but I was the train driver. I was doing some second unit on that, and Sam sent me to shoot some green screen of the train driver. And he said, it's not quite working. You be the train driver. So for a split second, I am the train driver coming in there.
In No Time to Die, Corbould explains how they shot an explosive chase in a centuries-old Italian city.
The first thing is obviously the script, and the script called for James Bond. You know, if you've seen the film, he's retired now. And because he was retired, you know, historically, James Bond's personal car is the DB5. So I had to go to Aston Martin. You know, we looked at the options. We came up with the idea that Aston Martin would supply the production too, for beauty shots of the car pulling up, Daniel getting in and out of the car, and the car pulling away. And then Aston Martin built 8 replicas. On top of 2 of those, we put a driving pod, so we could have a British rally champion, Mark Higgins, driving the car from a pod on the roof, so that we could have cameras looking in at Daniel and Leia as it was driving at 70 mile an hour through the streets. And, you know, unlike a green screen shot, you got the, where their eyes were looking, the G-forces of when they were going around corners, what their body would actually do. We also built 2 fully kitted out with all the gadgets. You know, obviously the spikes, the little bomblets coming out, smoke screen, the guns coming out the front. We had a lot of fun with that minigun. You know, one of the things we had to take into consideration, we shot the sequence in Matera, which is a thousands of year old historic town in Italy. And in the final sequence, where it's in the square and it donuts round, there's an 800 year old church there. And everything from 3 foot down was dressed in with all our bullet impacts in. And everything above that 3 foot was original 800 year old church. The car actually did a 360, and Daniel actually did a 360 in it. We locked the front wheel and used it as a pivot, but you know, most of that was done for real. And you know, one of the hardest bits was lining up the bullet impacts so that they lined up with the actual gun. So we divided the circle into 8 segments and had control boxes of, I think, 25 hits. There was lots of invisible visual effects in there. Whenever the cars were screeching around corners, and especially in the donut square, they were leaving black tire marks everywhere. So they, you know, we couldn't wait each time for them to be cleaned, because that was a 2-hour job each time. So they painted a lot of those out. They put a total digital car, the first car that got taken out by the bomblets, and realised that he needed to have that way blocked to make him turn the corner. So they put in a total CG car that got hit by the bomblets. They did lots of stuff like where the motorbike goes up the ramp, does that big jump. They made the ramp look like a piece of architecture, like a buttress. They painted out our driver in the driving pod. They painted him out a couple of times. So there was lots of invisible visual effects, which I think were really enhanced the whole sequence. It was a fun, fun shoot. And a lot of the success of that sequence depended on the collaboration with the townsfolk and the councils. And they really took us to their hearts and had a great time.
With the Dark Knight trilogy, Corbould created practical effects that helped keep Christopher Nolan's vision of Gotham City as realistic as possible.
The flying bat was, I must admit, when I first read it in the script, I was very, very disappointed. Because, you know, up until then, we'd made a real Batmobile that could do everything. We made a real bat bike. And all of a sudden, we've got this flying bat. My first discussion was with Chris, and I said to Chris, Chris, well, I don't get this. You know, we've done everything for real up to now, and now you're making this flying bat. But it's going to be all CGI. So he said, well, let's talk about it. So, you know, we sat down and we went through the scenes. First of all, there was the static bat, you know, when they first see it. Well, that had to be a real build. So we built the real bat. We actually built 2 of them. And then we started talking about scene by scene, you know, where it first comes out of the alleyway. Is that CG or is that real? And I said, well, I think we can do that on a zip line. which is what we did. We had two big cranes each end, zip line, and we pulled the bat out of the alleyway over the police cars. There were other scenes, you know, as we started going through it, I thought, yeah, this actually is gonna be fun. We mounted the bat on a vehicle that could go 60 mile an hour through the streets and go up, down, tilt left, tilt right, tilt forward, tilt back. The CGI guys painted out the vehicle, so we got a lot of value out of that when it was chasing the convoy. After a while, I was converted. So I think in some ways, Chris was really clever. And you know, from being very despondent about having a digital flying bat, you know, we probably achieved over 50% of what was shown in the film. So it worked out really well.
This dedication to practical effects included the challenge of flipping an entire semi-truck end over end.
Chris thinks big, everything he does is big. When we flipped the truck in Dark Knight, I wasn't sure we could do that. So I tried softening Chris up a little bit by asking him if maybe we just flipped the trailer unit and left the tractor unit flat. He didn't want to do that. And then I tried working on him to say, can we make it a shorter truck and not an 18-wheeler? And he didn't really want that. So, you know, in the end, I said, look, Chris, I'm going to go do a test site. And if I can't get it over, then we'll have to think of plan B, you know, whether it would be a miniature. Probably would have been a miniature. We went to the test site, the guy hit the button, and it flew over. We had two great big teeth in the front. So as soon as the bat lift off the ground, these teeth right dug into the ground and formed a natural hinge, because what we were worried about is that as soon as it lifted off, it just moved forward and we lost our momentum. So I thought we cracked it then. And then Chris wanted to do the shot in the main banking district. We went down the street, and then I was walking down. All I could see was manhole covers in the road, and all the way along the road, it was underground vaults, utility services. There was only two places on the whole road where we could actually do the shot. We were ready to do it, and we started pressurising the big nitrogen cylinders in the back. I said, Chris, well, we're ready. So he said, are you coming down to the camera? I said, no, I'm staying here. So we called action, and we sent the truck off on its way. And I thought to myself, there's going to be two outcomes here. There's going to be the loud whoosh of the cannon going off, sort of a little bit of quiet, and then the sound of a lot of breaking glass and deadly silence. Or there's going to be a loud whoosh of the cannon going off, a bit of a silence, a crash, and then loud applause. Luckily enough, it was the second one. So it was a total success.
When you hear the term movie magic, this is what they mean. Despite the endless applications of CGI, there's nothing quite like the real thing. So the next time you see something like this, remember that there are creative and technical wizards like Chris Corbould making it all happen. No matter if you're working with blockbusters or low-budget indies, all special effects require planning and coordination, which is where StudioBinder comes in. Follow the link below to sign up for free and start prepping your next special effects showstopper. If you haven't yet, subscribe to stay in the loop for more filmmaking videos. You won't want to miss who we interview next. Until next time, remember the following mantra: when in doubt, use a tank.